If we discover aliens, we'll probably see them because of their farts. The first signature of extraterrestrial life is likely to be unnatural compositions of gases in the atmosphere of a distant exoplanet. Think of the Earth. The atmosphere is full of oxygen, and this is only true because it keeps on being replenished by plant and microbial life. If life disappeared on Earth, so would the oxygen. So if we see a distant planet with an atmosphere where the proportions of gases are inexplicable by the laws of chemistry alone, like lots of oxygen or a mix of carbon dioxide and methane, but with little carbon monoxide, this would be a biosignature, a strong indicator that at least microbial life exists there. To confirm any large creatures exist, we'll just have to visit. But how do we know what chemicals the atmosphere of a distant planet contains? The answer is atomic spectroscopy. If we see a planet transiting in front of its star, some of that starlight is absorbed in a very specific pattern called an atomic absorption spectrum. Each element has a specific pattern, like a barcode, so through careful analysis of the light, it can tell us which gases are in the atmosphere and their proportions. We already use this technique for other space objects like stars and nebulae, measuring properties like temperature, density, ionization, and relative velocity. Think about how cool this is. We can look into deep space and get so much information just from the light. It's like a gift that the laws of physics have given us, and we've used it. Most of our knowledge of the universe comes from this technique. I've previously mentioned atomic spectra in my map of quantum physics video, and because this subject is so cool, I made this video to dig deeper. There are two kinds of atomic spectra: absorption spectra, which is where the light source is behind a gas and the gas absorbs and scatters certain wavelengths of light, leaving dark lines in the spectrum of the star. The opposite is emission spectra, which is the same process but seen from a different angle. Now you're only looking at the re-radiated light of this nebula. Here, it's worth noting a few things. A hot gas on its own emits light as an emission spectrum. Here, I'm drawing the intensity of the light on the vertical axis. A hot solid emits a spectrum at all wavelengths, called a thermal spectrum. And so you can't tell what material the object's made from, only how hot it is. And a star emits a combination of a thermal spectrum with an absorption spectrum superimposed on top, which comes from their upper layers. So in atomic spectra, why do we get these very specific lines? To answer that, we need to delve into the world of quantum mechanics. Light is absorbed and emitted by the electrons in atoms. And these electrons can only exist in certain energy states, which, plotted for hydrogen, look like this. The reason for these discrete energy states is that in quantum mechanics, electrons are described by a wave called a wave function. And this wave can only vibrate at certain frequencies in the constraint of the atom. This is just like a guitar string, which only vibrates at certain frequencies in the constraint of being tied to the guitar. These waves are standing waves, and each higher energy wave includes an extra half wavelength and oscillates at a higher frequency. I've simplified the drawings to one dimension, but in reality these are actually three-dimensional waves because the electron cloud is three-dimensional. As you go up, there's an infinite number of energy levels because you can keep on adding one more half wavelength to the electron wave. But the difference in energies between these levels gets smaller and smaller because the difference between the waves gets smaller and smaller. The biggest difference in energy is between the ground state and the first excited state. When light shines on atoms, if it contains light with the same energy as one of the distances between the energy levels of the electron, it can absorb that light, and the electron jumps to a higher energy. Then, later, it will jump back down to a lower energy, emitting the light in a random direction. This is why we see dark bands in the absorption spectrum, because the electrons are absorbing the light and then scattering it mostly in a different direction to the original light. So it's taking out those frequencies of the light. And an emission spectrum is just made of that scattered light. Light is made of particles called photons, and the energy of a photon is based solely on its frequency, which you can see from this equation, E equals HF, where H is a constant called Planck's constant. Also, the frequency and wavelength are related to each other inversely by this equation, where C is the speed of light in a vacuum. Here we have part of the emission spectrum from hydrogen. You'll notice that there are three groups of spectral lines. Now, there's a good reason for this. The first group is called the Lyman group. It is made from all the decays from high energy states down to the ground state. The other groups come from energy decays from above down to higher energy levels in a similar way. That's why the lines are grouped like this. Note that this is not to scale. In reality, these lines are far more spread out in the wavelength scale. And there are even more series at longer wavelengths. You should also note that I've only been using hydrogen as examples because it's only got one proton and one electron, so it's got a relatively simple spectrum. But the spectra of other elements are more complex, and a real observation of many, many different gases overlapping is incredibly complex. Now you know all the basics of atomic spectra, but it's also worth knowing about fine structure and hyperfine structure. These are where, if you look at a spectral line really closely, you'll see that they're often made of two or more spectral lines that are incredibly close together. The atomic spectra we've talked about so far are an idealized model, but when you add in the spin of the electron and also relativistic effects, you get the fine structure splitting of energy levels. And beyond that, the hyperfine structure is seen as small shifts and splittings of these energy levels caused by interaction between the electrons and the nucleus through their mutual magnetic or electric fields, as well as other effects. Now, it's important to note that what I've described so far isn't the only way that light interacts with matter. There are a few other ways that you should know about. The most common is scattering, which happens when electrons are free to wiggle about when light shines on them, called Rayleigh scattering. You don't need the rules of quantum physics to describe this. It's a classical effect of light being a vibrating electromagnetic wave which interacts with the electric charge of the electrons, causing them to wobble, and they then become an oscillating source of more electromagnetic waves which radiate out in all directions. This scattering is what causes the blue colour of the sky and the red colour of sunsets. It's also why metals are very reflective, because they have lots of free electrons that move around very easily. We've also got Raman scattering, where light shines on molecules and can vibrate the molecules in different modes, and it's got its own spectroscopy called Raman spectroscopy. And there's also Brillouin scattering, where light can lose or gain energy when interacting with vibrational waves in the atomic lattices of solids. Finally, let's look at the applications of atomic spectra. I've already mentioned the array of uses in astrophysics. The other main use is to see what elements and compounds something is made of. This is used in chemistry labs to see what a sample is made of, or using the hyperfine structure to delve into the nucleus with nuclear magnetic resonance and other techniques. Lasers come from controlling the emissions from specific energy levels. We can also harness the accuracy and repeatability of the energy levels. For example, atomic clocks all need a standard oscillator to keep the same time, and so use the light from a specific hyperfine transition of the cesium-133 atom, which is also how the SI units of distance, the meter, and time, the second, are defined. And so this also sets the definition of the speed of light. So that's my introduction to atomic spectra. Very cool stuff. I'll be looking at other topics from the map of quantum physics in the future, so consider subscribing if you want to catch those. This post is still available on DFTBA as well. And if you value my videos and would like to help support me make them, I have a Patreon page where you can donate anything from $1 per video to get access to some behind the scenes material. Lately I've been posting work in progress scripts and images, and also video previews before they go live on YouTube. But no obligation, I appreciate you watching, and I'll see you in the next video.